Hello, this is Spartan Commander, and this is the 255th Rome Total War Brotherhood game that I've put onto YouTube. Just before I introduce the teams, I would just like to talk a little bit about the lag that we experience on 4v4 large battles on Steam. As I understand it, RTW was developed originally to be played on the GAMESPY server, GS, and very often the 4v4 large battles used to work well on GameSpy. I would say 80-85% of the games played at the right speed, and you know, anybody with a mid-range computer or mid-speed internet could play 4v4 large quite happily. But since we moved on to Steam, we've all noticed that there has been a real lag problem on 4v4 large battles. And it seems that even if you've got a fast computer or fast internet, there always seems to be lag in varying degrees on 4v4 large battles. And so I thought I would just put this this battle on. It was fought approximately 6 or 7 years ago on the GameSpy server. And you may well see the difference of how smoothly the units move and how they move at the correct speed as well. Okay, the team I'm in today consists of Wolves member Galacia. A lot of RTW veterans remember Wolves Galacia, a very good player of his day. As I say, this battle was fought between 6 and 7 years ago. Our next teammate is Brotherhood member Cal, who has bought the Rome Bruto faction. And then our next teammate is Brotherhood member Mystique, who has bought the Rome SBQR faction. And then the last member of our team is myself, Spartan Commander, who's also bought the Rome SBQR faction. So there's our team there, full of experience. This should be a great battle for you watch. You wait till you see the other team. Bags and bags of experience in the other team too. And as I say, this battle was fought approximately 6 to 7 years ago and should be a great one for you to watch. And here is that other team. As you can see, you've got RTW player Scorpion King SR, a very experienced RTW player. Has been playing Rome Total War since it first came out, and he has bought the Seleucid faction. I think he's got something like about 9 pike units there. But if you notice also, he's got 5 archer units. Now remember, pike factions are very susceptible, large pike factions are very susceptible to archer fire, so you need to bring archers of your own to give your pikemen that archer cover there. And then of course he's got the infamous Cataphract Cavalry. If you notice, the upgrades on this cavalry are 8 upgrades, so that's 2 experience stripes, gold shield, gold attack. And if we have a close-up look, we can see where we call these the tanks of the ancient world. They're armoured from head to toe and used correctly can be battle-winning troops. So looking at that Seleucid army from 6 or 7 years ago, I think Scorpion King's got a very good army there. Also, just one more thing about that army. Can you see he's bought a unit of peasants? Now if you can get these peasants to stand their ground, they'll soak up enemy pilers as good as any more expensive units would. So as long as they stand their ground, they're pretty good pilot shield units. Their next teammate is Cornovi. I think a lot of you know him, Cornovi, or One Eye, as he used to be called. And he's bought the Rome Julio faction. And if you notice, even Cornovi has bought a unit of peasants there. As I said before, they are good pilot soakers and cheap as well. And if you notice, this unusual cavalry formation that Cornovi has bought as well. You don't see cavalry formations like that very often. Should be interesting to see how well it does. And their third teammate is Brotherhood member Killer, and he has bought the Rome Julio faction. Just draw your attention there, he's got 4 archer units there, so it'll be interesting to see how well those archers do during the course of the battle. And their fourth teammate is Brotherhood member Crimson Overlord. He's called himself Kong Ming, but I believe it is Brotherhood member Crimson Overlord, and he's bought the Greek Citus faction there. If you notice, he's got mostly Spartans there, a lot of Spartan units. And if you notice, it is general, it's a cavalry general unit. Very, very unusual to see a cavalry general unit for the Greek Citus faction. And also, he's got some, I think it's like militia cavalry there. Yeah, militia cavalry. These are missile cavalry. So there's his Greek Citus army. Let's say it should be a great one for you to watch. Okay, right at the very, very beginning of this battle, even before we formed up, can you see Scorpion King is laying out his attacking credentials? As you see in other battle videos, Scorpion King always attacks, very aggressive. He likes to seize the initiative right at the beginning of the battle. He likes to keep the enemy on the back foot. And if you notice here, even 6 or 7 years ago, he's always been this aggressive attacking player there, moving forwards. As I say, always trying to grab the initiative right at the beginning of the battle. You notice he's running his archers over there, hoping to target some of our units as they're forming up, hitting them in the side or the rear there to cause casualties. And if you notice there, can you see, you might see how kind of smooth and speedy the units are moving right at the beginning of the battle. As I say, in if this was in Steam now, right at the beginning of the battle, you'd notice that things were really laggy and like kind of just slowly crunching along. Right, you can see that Scorpion King's taking those Selucid tank cavalry cataphracts over in a threatening manner towards Mystique's SPQR cavalry. Mystique, knowing that those Selucid tank cavalry have got those effective against armor maces, doesn't really want to get into too much of a tussle with those cavalry. So wise move pulling back there. If you notice, I've got my SPQR cavalry ready there as well, which I'd have thrown in if Mystique had attacked. Right, let's just pause the game for a second. Right, just like to draw your attention here. Can you see how Scorpion King got his 5 archer units there, protected by 2 pike units in front of him to stop any cavalry attack coming in? If you notice there, Scorpion King's firing fire arrows. So as we said before, not only just lowering morale, but causing casualties. As I say, protected by those 2 pike units there to stop any cavalry attacks. He's got his Selucid tank cavalry on the flank to stop any cavalry trying to get around the flank of those pikes there. And he's got pike units plus his allies' cavalry over on the other flank. So that's a pretty good defense for those archers there. They can fire and cause as many casualties as they want without being able to be attacked by any of our forces there. As you can see, Scorpion King firing loads and loads of arrows into Mystique's one of Mystique's archer units there. As I say, those big pike units very susceptible to archer fire, so it's important that Scorpion King's archers try and neutralise the enemy archers as soon as possible. Even though, unfortunately, his archers have only got short range. As I say, you can see Scorpion King has aggressive tendencies straight away there as he's moving out. As I say, we hadn't even formed up. We haven't even formed up yet. And his actions there have made us have to react to him, which is what he wanted. As I say, in RTW, if you grab the initiative, the enemy has to respond to your movements. Right, if you notice here, can you see, just going to pause the game for a second here, can you see that I'm pulling my infantry over to this this flank a little bit more over here, onto the end of that pike wall. We've got a lot of cavalry behind us ready to attack. And let's go right over to our right flank here. Now, can you see our ally Wolves Galatia? Now, I don't know whether he didn't move very fast or whatever, but he's kind of a bit isolated there, right out on our right flank. And you can guarantee that Crimson Overlord with his Greek citizen killer with his Julia army there have spotted that. And that they may well try an isolation tactic of trying to cut him off from our, you know, from his allies there, because it's a long way between him and his allies if he did get cut off. As you can see, Cal is heading towards Scorpion King's infantry as well. Let's see what happens next here. Alright, as you can see, I'm continuing bringing my SPQR infantry over to the flank of this this kind of pike wall here. But if you notice that Scorpion King's bought another line of pikes out there to extend his pike wall to give his archers even more protection. He was trying to bring his archers out to the flank look, so he could target the flank of our units there. So that's why he's bringing his archers out there. Plus also he can target our cavalry if we come in range. If you notice, he's keeping his archers in close tight formation there, and that's because he knows that in close tight formation their arrows have got more impact and can do more damage. Right, let's just pause the game for a second here. So as you can see here is archers shooting fire arrows here into my cavalry. Can you see I've got my cavalry positioned opposite those archers? But so what he's doing now, he's targeting my cavalry with his fire archers. So I've got two choices. I can either retreat, or if I wanted to, I could attack those archers. But with those Selucid tank cavalry just behind them. Would that be a wise move? It'd be interesting to see. Yeah, what do you think you would do with your cavalry? Do you think you would attack those archers, or do you think you just pull back out of range? What do you think you would do here? Maybe pull back out of range? That might be the sensible option. But, oh no, looks like I'm not taking a sensible option. I'm attacking those archers. If you notice, I'm bringing over some of my infantry units to try and neutralize the enemy cavalry, and bang, as our cavalry hits. Okay, so I've got light lances or my swords there against the effective against armored Seleucid cavalry. Okay, I've thrown a couple of my infantry units in there as well. I'm hoping that maybe my allies might send over some cavalry support, because if we could take out this Seleucid cavalry on this flank, it would be a major thing for the course of the battle. Can you see that Mystique is sending in some cavalry units there to help? Let's say I'm sending in infantry units as well. Now you can see Scorpion King sending one of his pike units over. Now remember, friendly pikes kill friendly cavalry. So if he puts those pikes down and then tries to retreat his cavalry through those pikes, he will lose cavalry on friendly pikes. Right, let's just have a close-up of this this battle here. Right, if you notice the Seleucid cavalry, can you see those effective against armor maces there? Those are very, very effective against armor there, and they're quite crucial in the use of that cavalry. If you notice, up against my SBQR cavalry there, with their light lances, or some of them have got their swords out there. So that'll be interesting to see what happens. As I say, if we could take out this Seleucid cavalry this end, then that could make a big difference to what's happening on this flank. Just looking up the battle line there, you can see that Mystique is facing some more Seleucid pikemen. But can you see here, Cal and Glacier have done a double charge, cavalry charge, into, I think it's Cornovoy's infantry there. That's a nice, massive cavalry charge there. But if you notice that the Greek cities, enemy Greek cities units are closing in on Wolves Galatia's infantry, pressing home their attack, and you can see Killer's got his infantry there ready to advance. And if you notice also, Killer's got cavalry out there as well, ready to charge in when he's ready. Plus, if you notice at the back there, he's got his archer units shooting fire arrows into our allies' Brutii force there. Like we said before, like we said earlier, that those infantry are in tight, close formation, which helps with the impact of the arrows. And shooting fire arrows, as we said before, will not just cause casualties, but put fear into the enemy and lower their morale. So there's a lot going on all over the battlefield at the moment, trying to show you everything that I can there. Right, can you notice this nice little cavalry move there by Mist, taking a cavalry unit in behind and then bang, charges it in, plus bringing other cavalry units in through my cavalry units into attacking the Seleucid infantry. If we can just kill that Seleucid general, we know that Seleucid morale is not very good, so if we could kill the general there, that would lower the Seleucid morale even more, so that must be a target. If you notice that the Seleucid general, there you go. We've just managed to kill the Seleucid general, and can you notice almost instantaneously all those Seleucid units that were fighting have just routed because their morale has dropped so badly. So, over here on the left flank, we appear to have done quite well in taking out that Seleucid cataphract tank cavalry. So now what we need to do now is to start taking our forces, moving them over to the right flank there to help our allies out. Right, you notice that Scorpion King has seen what's happened on his flank there and has brought his pike units over here now. My guess is he's going to put a pike wall up there to try and protect his allies' flank from our forces coming in from that flank. There, as you see, Scorpion King's put a line of his pikemen out there ready to put his pikes down to protect the flank of his allies there. Remember, the red Rome, the Greek cities, and the Seleucid are the enemy team, and we are the leader of allies. We are the Rome swayed. Green and purple. So just at a glance, us, there you can see exactly what's happening. Okay, let's just pause again for a second. Right, you can see here the Greek cities advancing on our allies' units there. Killer's charging as well, being very aggressive with his infantry and cavalry. You can see Cal's green Brutii units there, and you can see Cornovoy's red Julia army there is a little bit distant from his allies. You see you've got Scorpion King there with his pikes, and you can see that we've got a lot of cavalry advantage over on that flank. If we can get some cavalry in behind those enemy troops, then maybe that could well be a very important thing to do. Right, can you see this green Brutio cavalry charging into the enemy Julio units there? And bang, as that cavalry hits. Nice cav hit there, and well done to Julio infantry units for holding it against that. Right, can you see that Galatia's got some green Brutio cavalry in behind the enemy troops there? There's a lot of really nice tactical moves going on here with both cavalry and infantry in this battle. And bang, as Galatia charges that that Brutio cavalry into the back, those units there. Right, let's just pause the game for a second. As I said earlier, can you see that Cornovi's red Julio army there has got a little bit isolated from his allies and is gradually actually getting surrounded by our troops? If you notice, I've got my SBQR army and Mystique's got some units over there. Now if you notice that Cal's got some Brutii cavalry out there, I wonder where he'll charge those in. But as you can see, a lot of our allies' Brutii units are starting to rout over on that far right flank. Okay, now can you see where a Cal might charge his cavalry in here? Can you see a place that would be a great place for him to charge in? I can. Can you see the isolated Julii? Right, there you go. He's going for the isolated Julii army there, Cornovi, and bang, as that cavalry hits. So basically, that isolated Julii army, if you look, is basically surrounded now. So the morale of all those troops are going to be dropping quite considerably. If you notice, Cal's taking his cavalry on through, just charge them on through those Julii infantry there, which will be causing casualties, knocking their morale down. And there you can see most of that army now is starting to rout. Now, could this be a pivotal part of the battle here? I think taking that Seleucid cavalry out was maybe a pivotal part of a battle, but here, taking out basically a whole enemy Julii army could well be pivotal here. If you notice, I'm charging some SBQR cavalry into back of some engaged pike units there. Right, let's just pause the game for a second. Okay, so at this stage of the battle, you can see we've basically taken out Cornovi's Julii army here. Most of the Seleucid army has been taken out as well, so things are looking extremely good for our team on the left flank and now in the left center. Meanwhile, over on our right flank there, you can see that Killer's red Julii army in combination with Crimson Overlord's Greek Cities armies there has done extremely well there on our right flank, taking out lots of units. You see Mystique's got a unit there just putting into Testudo, surrounded by Greek City units and Julii units there. Of course, if you put units into Testudo, it just kind of slows down that steamroller advance by pike units there. So over on our right flank, the enemy seems to have done quite well. And as I say, over on the left of our flank and the left centre, we seem to have seems to have done quite well there. But the thing is, I think we've lost a lot of infantry. If you notice there, yes, we've got quite a bit of cavalry, but if you notice, we seem to have lost a lot of infantry. Now, as you know, fighting Greek cities, those Spartans, you need, you know, a reasonable amount of infantry to be able to take them on. So I think it'll be interesting to see what happens as the battle unfolds even more now. The enemy's hearts are full of fear, and now of course, what the Greek City General would like is for us to attack him head on, so that's not what we're going to do. Right, if you notice there, the Greek City General is forming up there, as I say, facing us, hoping that we would attack his pikes head on. Well, of course, being experienced players, we don't really want to do that. We want to flank. If you notice here, you can see the red Julii cavalry and that Greek City's cavalry there, and you can see our allies, SBQR cavalry and Brutii cavalry, waiting to be positioned. You can see my infantry, I'm trying to go around the flank of the Greek City's units there. As I say, I don't want to take them head on. I just want to try and get them in the flank, or preferably in the rear, attack them from the rear. But I think veterans watching this as well, seeing all those Greek City units that we've got to fight, and seeing the small amount of infantry that we've got left, as you can see, this could be a bit of a bit of a struggle here, and you can see that the enemy have still got some Julii Roman infantry left as well. So I think there's going to have to be a lot of tactical movement here for us to try and take on. You can see, look at all those Greek City Spartan units there. Remember, Spartan units have got excellent morale, excellent specifications, and 2 hit points. And don't forget, they've also got the anti-cavalry bonus that pike units have got as well. So even though we might have a lot of cavalry, we have to be extremely careful in how we use them when facing anti-cavalry pike units. You can see Cal's just taken out one of the enemy Julio units over here. See, there's quite a lot of enemy Julii troops left, both cavalry and infantry as well. And if you look at our troops, remember we're SBQR, the purple SBQR and green Brutii. So if you look, if you just look at the troop ratio on the battlefield there, you'll see that we have not got a lot of infantry left. And as I say, when you take on the Greek cities, those Spartans, really, you need quite a bit of infantry, really. And Crimson Overlord is extremely good with pike units, and especially with the Greek cities. So as you can see here, can you see I'm pulling my infantry back? I don't want a head-on, face-on clash with those pikes there. But of course, because those units were isolated from the general and they'd already been battle damaged, they've routed now, but I'm hoping they're going to rally. Right, just pause the game for a second to take stock of exactly what's happened. As I say there, there's lots of Spartan units left. And don't forget, and the red Julii are the enemy team, and we are the SBQR, the purple SBQR, and the green Brutii army there. So just at a glance there, you can see that in the middle there is that big nub of Greek cities and red Julii units there. And you can see we've got lots of units spread out all around the battlefield. Let's say we don't want to concentrate an infantry attack on the front of those Spartan units. We're going to have to be very tactical and try and do a lot of movement around those pike units. But as you can see now, you can see this is going to be an extremely close battle whichever way this goes. And looking at all those Spartans left on the battlefield there, and its Julii allies, I don't think it's looking that particularly good for our team. Well, I'm just going to pause the game here for a second just to show you a tactical thing that's just occurred. And can you see that the enemy Julii army has moved away from its Greek cities allies? And the Greek cities, if you notice, have moved away from its Julii. So those two armies are now split. Now, can you see I'm running my SBQR infantry forward? What I'd like to do is get in between those two armies so we can isolate that Julii army and take it out. Okay, so straight away I've spotted that that's what we need to do. As the Greek cities have pulled over to attack our Brutii ally, if I can just get in between them and their Julii ally there, and maybe my allies can get some cavalry in there as well, we might be able to take out that whole Julii army before they can get back over to their Greek cities allies. Right, okay, time is the essence here. Right, can you see my allies with their cavalry have spotted that as well? Now, can you see the Julii general has spotted the danger and is now moving back over to his Greek cities allies, but has he left it too late? As bang! That SBQR cavalry hits.
To fill the heart of the enemy general with fear.
Now, and if you notice there, I'm sending a cavalry unit in from the flank as well, and bang, we've taken out the Julii general, and we've done what we wanted to do. We've just taken out those that Julii army there. Just did you see there a tactical move there by them that they split up, and we took full advantage of that and took out that Julii army. So now we've got to concentrate on the Greek cities. As I said before, remember these Greek City Spartan units have got 2 hit points, excellent morale, and excellent specifications. So it'll be interesting to see what happens here. As you notice here, we haven't got a lot of infantry, and the infantry that we have got is battle damaged. Luckily, I've still got some pilers left that I'm going to throw into those Spartans. But as you know, with those 2 hit points, pilers don't do really a lot of damage to those Spartan units. So to try and take this Spartan army out, it's going to have to be extremely tactical. And when you're up against a really good player like Crimson Order or Greek City, you're going to have to be very tactical, right? Can you see I'm pulling my infantry back? Did you see that he was moving forward with those Spartan units trying to entice me to attack him head on? But instead of that, I moved my infantry back. We still got some archer units, but how many arrows they've got left, I don't know. They might have to be turned into infantry in the latter stages of this battle. As you can see, the Greek city's generals moving very, very tactically here. I was moving back, knows that his flanks and rear are the weakest part of his formation, so he's going to keep pulling back. He doesn't want to be flanked. He's going to have to keep an eye on all our cavalry as well. Let's say he's got that mobile cavalry general. Extremely unusual to see a Greek city's cavalry general, but it seems to have worked for him. He can move that cavalry around fast around the battlefield, giving them morale. Right, did you see I got a little bit caught there? I was trying to get three units around the flank of the Greek city's units there, but he sent in some light cavalry to take out those archers, and his Spartans are moving towards my infantry. Little bit slow there, maybe I should have run my infantry back, but now I'm in a position where I'm actually fighting those there. See, now I'm trying to run those units back. To say I'm playing the Greek city's general's game here now by taking those Spartan units on head on. So that's not a very good tactical decision by me. And my guess is that those light cavalry and that light general unit there, you'll be charging into the back of my engaged infantry, trying to rout them there. So as you can see, there's a general overview of the battle at the moment. There you are. There's that cavalry general. I'm bang, and it charged into the back of my infantry there. And my guess is he'll pull that general unit back. There you go. He'll refocus and then charge back in again. And there you go, and this time he routed those units there. So all the time we're losing a lot of our infantry units there. And as you can see at the moment, those Spartan units there seem to be, seem to be winning the day. Right, let's just pause the game for a second. As you can say, as I said earlier, really to take out Spartans you need a lot of infantry. And if you can see, yes, we've got quite a bit of cavalry, but we are very, infantry depleted. Infantry deficient here against the Spartans. As I say, even though we've got more cavalry, those Spartan units, obviously like all pike units there, have got anti-cavalry bonus, so we're gonna have to be extremely careful how we use our cavalry here. Right, if you notice, I'm moving my infantry back again. Right, can you see these archer units here have run out of arrows, so the general is alt attacked. They've got their small daggers out as they charge into the flank of those Spartans. If you notice here, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, I think we've got about like 6 infantry units, maybe 7, but they're all extremely battle damaged now. And I would think, looking at that Spartan force, it would only be a matter of time before, they take out our infantry, and then we'd just be left with cavalry, and then that'd probably be the end of the battle there. Right from the beginning, do you remember when we took out that Seleucid cavalry and rolled their flank up from that left to right? I thought we might have done enough to have won the battle there. I thought that might have been a pivotal part of the battle. Then when we took out Cornovoy's Julia army, I thought, well, that would definitely be a pivotal part of the battle. But as it goes to show, you can't ever be sure of victory until the end. And looking at this particular battle, I'm not sure that we should have been so pleased about what happened earlier, because I don't think, as I say, if you look at the number of Spartans that's left against our infantry, it looks pretty bad at the moment. Right, can you see the Brucho cavalry trying to get that cavalry general there? If he can just take out that Greek city's cavalry general. There, he's been routed. So that's good. Even though the Spartans have got excellent morale, losing their general, their morale will drop. Now, those Spartan units are also battle depleted. If you look at the numbers in those units, you will see they are actually battle depleted. They've suffered a lot of casualties, so losing their general, their morale will now drop. So you know, if we can maybe get a couple of heavy cavalry hits in here, the shock of the cavalry hitting them might just be enough, possibly, to spark off a chain right. Can you see the Brutio general going to charge into the back of those Greases? But they spotted him and he stopped his cavalry charge. Nice move there by, I think it's Cal. He didn't continue the cavalry attack there. That was a good move. Right, just pause the game for a second here. So as you can see, our SBQR infantry are now engaging those Greek city Spartans. Now maybe, just maybe, if we can get cavalry in behind them, because now they're engaged, and maybe, I don't know, surgically hit with our cavalry. As I said, the shock of the cavalry hitting might... Right, you see the Bruto general's going to charge in again, but then he saw the Greek cities turn with their pikes and decided to back off. Nice move by that. But by doing that, can you see the SBQR general's got a chance of charging his cavalry in as well? Bang! If you notice, I'm pushing my infantry forward as well there to engage those Greek cities. Now, if Cal moves in with his cavalry from the other side, the shock of that cavalry hitting could well possibly spark off a mass rout here. Right, can you see a lot of the Greek city units are now routing? Can you see I'm pushing my infantry forward hard as well? And it looks like we've managed to create a chain rout of those Greek city units. Well, I never thought we I never thought we'd be able to do that. So really well played to Cal, really well played to Mystique there, really well played all the team there. That was really well done. Okay, first thing I'd like to say is really well played to everybody in the game there. Some really great moves, some nice tactical moves, and some great attacking moves there. Just like to say, really nice kills to Mystique, 1,980. That's very nice, kills from Mystique there. And also, if you notice that Crimson Overlord Kong Ming did well with his Greek city's army there. Galatia, poor Galatia got caught in... a double hit up on that right flank, so didn't get many kills. Just like to draw your attention, you can see I've got the smallest army in the game by far, but I've managed to get the second best kills. So maybe it's not so much the size of the army that you bring, but how you use it, as we've said in other battle videos. So once again, really well done to Killer, Crimson, Cornovoy, and Scorpion King, and really well done to the team I was in. Hope you enjoy the battle. Bye for now.